And now, Vijay Mukherjee from UT Dallas.
Good afternoon. I'm Vijay Mukherjee and I'm representing my team, Radha Mukherjee and Subodh Kumar. The title of my talk today is To Show or Not to Show, Using User Profiling to Manage Internet Ad Campaigns at Chitika. Chitika is a small startup internet ad firm. And before we get into the presentation, let me begin with a small experiment that will help you understand what we did at Chitika. So imagine you are a small manufacturing firm and you are interested in buying powered generators to run a machine. And you know about this website which contains a lot of information about powered generators. So you go to your favorite browser and you type in the website URL. So out comes the site. In the site there is a lot of interesting content, but there are also ads. These are typically ads for companies that sell power generators. So look at this part, and I'm showing it with the mouse. There are a few ads for companies selling power generators. Who is supplying these ads? Let's take a closer look. These ads are coming from Google, not surprisingly. In that page, there were no other ads. But I will soon do another experiment which will show you how the ads for this page change. So rather than going directly to this website, let us say that you did not know about this www.powergenerators.com. Instead, you went to Google and you did a search for power generators. So you typed in power generators, did a search. I saved you some of the tedium here. And let us go to the same website, www.powergenerators.com, but this time via the search engine. Okay, now we see something different. We see a new ad has popped up. This Google ad is still around. But there is a new ad, and this ad comes from Chitika, the company that we worked with. Just to prove that, I showed you what is behind the ad. So during my presentation, I will explain to you why this happened, why the user did not get Chitika's ad when he went directly, and why they got Chitika's ad when they went via a search engine. To help you better understand the architecture that supplies ads when a user visits a web page, to see the process, let us look at a small example. So this is you, who is either typing a URL directly or typing a search string on Google or Bing or your favorite search engine. Then you go to a website. We will use the word publisher for this website. These are called publishers in the internet ad industry. When you reach the publisher's site, a program fires within the site called a script, which sends an ad request. This ad request basically goes to Chitika. So assume that Chitika is managing the ads for that publisher. So if that is the case, the ad request goes to Chitika, then it goes to a machine which decides which of the regions of the country or the world this user request is coming from. So that is a geo-balancer. This geo-balancer sends the request to one of the data centers that Chitika runs. So I'm showing the 5 US data centers. Once it hits one of these data centers, some logic happens within the data center which picks the search string, collects whatever other information they can, and then serves an ad back to the user. A little blow up of what happens inside the data center. Within each data center, there are several hundred ad servers. So once a request comes to an ad, a data center, there is a load balancer which decides which of these ad servers should field that request. And then below the ad servers, you see a log processor. A log processor is nothing but a machine that keeps track of all the transactions that happen during this ad delivery process. And what is most important to remember is that if a user clicks on an ad, that is when all commerce begins to happen. Revenue starts getting generated. 98% of the internet ad industry is run by the pay-per-click model. So the impression is free for the advertiser. But if the user clicks on the ad, then an amount has to pass from the advertiser and ultimately reach the publisher. So these impressions, these events of impressions and these events of clicks are very important to audit and very important to store, and that is where the log processor comes in. Different players exist in this industry. I've talked about advertisers. So an advertiser might be Toyota. Advertiser might be University of Phoenix, advertising their online program for nurses. An ad firm is a firm that helps advertisers place ads to the right users coming on different websites. Chitika is an example of an ad firm. Google, among other things, is a big gorilla ad firm. The publisher I already mentioned. Publisher is a website that attracts users with their content so that ads can be shown, and that is how the content is monetized by the publisher. Finally, there have to be web users who ultimately are the recipients of these ads, who hopefully will click on ads and further may even buy products once they go to the website to which those ads are directing them to. Our problem is for the ad firm Chitika, and I said that we will consider a pay-per-click model. Now, interestingly, the advertiser, given the pay-per-click model, and the ad firm basically want to maximize clicks. The more the clicks, the more the revenue. Now, this is partly the case for the publisher, but not entirely. The publisher also cares about impressions. So think of yourself as a publisher. You are giving your real estate, namely the web page, to a firm to use it to generate revenue. Now, what if they show 100 million impressions in, say, 3 months, and there are 20,000 clicks? What if another ad firm is able to generate 20,000 clicks with a tenth of those impressions? Clearly, the publisher will prefer, for the same revenue, will prefer the more efficient ad firm. The reason being that now they have got so much of real estate available for more potential revenue opportunities. So the important thing to remember is the publisher cares about this measure called click-through rate. A click-through rate is nothing but the number of clicks divided by the number of impressions. Whereas the ad firm and the advertiser essentially wants to maximize revenue, and revenue is maximized when there are more clicks. So let us now see what we did in this context, because we see that there is an objective and then there is another player in the supply chain which is more interested in an objective like click-through rate. So as an ad firm, Chitika has to make money for publishers. There's no publisher is going to come to Chitika if the check at the end of the month is small. So yes, the publisher wants a large check. But publishers also care about click-through rate. So to respect the interests of the publishers, what we do is we filter the ads. We look at something about the user, collect some intelligence, and show ads to only certain users. Too much filtering can be bad because revenue can fall. So the goal is to maximize revenue subject to a efficiency constraint. Let us see this in a picture. Visitor X comes in. X stands for all the information we have about the visitor. Then we run a predictive model which tells us what is the probability of this user clicking on an ad that we are about to or intend to show him or her. If that probability is sufficiently high, we show the ad, otherwise we back out. We say we don't want to clutter your website. What happens if you back out? The ad unit collapses. There's no white space showing glaringly in the publisher's web page, obviously. So a smarter solution is made. Either the content expands or other ads can be shown by that publisher dealing with other ad firms. But Chitika doesn't show that its ad because it feels that this is not a case where the user is likely to click. Of course, when you show an ad, there is no guarantee that there will be a click. So there could be a click, there could not be a click. Hopefully, we want to create models where the click is more likely. So our solution consists of two main steps, a data analytics step and a decision analytics step. The data analytics step has to do with predicting the probability of the click. The decision analytics step has to do with, given that probability P, is it worthwhile to show the ad or not? So in this picture, you see alpha, the Greek symbol alpha, is really a decision variable in the model. Should we show the ad at a certain click probability? The third piece of the puzzle is feedback. So in real time, we capture these events. What happened when we showed the ad? Did the user click? Did the user not click? And this feedback is used in the model. And I will soon tell you how it is used in the model. So in summary, we are doing real-time data analytics and decision analytics. Quickly, data analytics component we call in sort of a grand way, profit. And we have filed a patent for it. It uses a lot of predictor variables, and we will show you some of them. It is basically a logit model, because recall that what we are trying to predict is a number between 0 and 1. So it's a probability, logit, probit, we are using logit here. Some of the candidate variables used here, and we'll look at some of the interesting ones. There is a bunch of variables that you get from that real-time event in the meta tag of the HTTP request. So directly we know what is your operating system, what browser is the user using, what search engine, if there was a search engine. Button search, BTN search, is a very interesting thing we found. If you look at Google, there are two ways you can execute a search. Of course, you have to type a search string. But at the end of that, you can either press enter or you can say Google search. Those people who say Google search are more likely to click on ads than those people who press enter. That is what our prediction says over millions and millions of clicks and transactions. So this is an interesting trend. Bad spellers are more likely to click than good spellers. So I just gave you a few interesting things. Then we come to a bunch of variables which are to do with the cookie of the user. A cookie is a temporary file stored on your hard disk by the website. And in the internet, the cookies are probably the world's largest distributed database being handled today. So there are billions of users on the internet, And most users, about 99% of them, do not turn off cookies. You can opt out of that by turning off cookies, but you will lose a lot of functionality as you browse the web. Now, what do we get from this cookie information? What we get typically is, in the last 20 searches, the cookie is limited to about 384 kilobytes. So in the last 20 searches, what happened for this user, we can collect and we can analyze. So total number of clicks by this visitor in the past on similar search strings. So we have a similarity metric which does that. And the others are similar. But this bunch that we are showing now are all is coming from the cookie. Finally, there are some ad variables which deal with the nature of the ad, the size, where it's actually very important to know where the ad is on being displayed on the web page. So that is location X and Y, the X and Y coordinates of the ad. So if it is being shown prominently, there's more likelihood of a click. Sorry, one more thing was the dependent variable. The whole goal of this model is to predict whether there will be a click or not. So it's a 0-1 variable, but logit gives you a number between 0 and 1, which is the probability. Now, once we looked at these events and we fitted this logit model, we could now estimate the frequency of users who have different click probabilities. So this is just a histogram of click probabilities and frequencies. And say, for example, we set a threshold of alpha 0.01, which means we will show ads only to those users where the P, click probability, is greater than 0.01. So what will basically happen is that we will show only in the shaded region. And it turns out that when we did some estimation, this curve that I've shown there is a very good match with the beta distribution. So once you know this estimated distribution, you can figure out what these probabilities really are for any given value of alpha. So it's nothing but the area under the curve is the probability, the shaded part, is the probability of showing an impression. So that's what we call impression probability. And this is self-explanatory. We just integrate between alpha to 1. That's the upper tail of the beta distribution. Then the other important characteristic, and just notice that is as you tighten alpha, you move up alpha, you get less of the integral range. So clearly, this impression probability decreases in alpha. The other important variable that we can control is the filtered click probability. So suppose we did no filtering, alpha was zero. There is some average probability in the population of people clicking. But if you filter, what happens is that you only admit those who are more likely to click. So you would expect the filtered click probability to be higher than the population mean. And that is precisely what happens. Again, that is increasing in alpha, it can be easily shown. So in other words, if you tighten your threshold, you make it higher, you increase the average click-through rate that you expect to see. So finally, we have something like a model here set up. The tildes have appeared, something I didn't allude to earlier. The tilde just implies that it is a random variable. Remember that there is a distribution of p-values, click probabilities of users who are coming into the website. So the number of clicks that will happen in a planning horizon, say we typically these contracts are for a month. So the number of clicks you expect to see in a month as a function of alpha will be a random variable. So will the click-through rate be a random variable. This thing that you see below, the expectation, is nothing but the click-through rate. And the eta, this variable, is something that the publisher chooses. The publisher chooses a value of the click-through rate that he or she wants to impose on Chitika. Say, make me the most money you can, but don't fall below this click-through rate. That is how the contract is set up. A little bit of math, how we evaluate the objective functions. Reasonably straightforward, I won't spend much time on it. Just to remind you that you get a binomial distribution for the probability of eye impressions and also for the probability of J clicks given eye impressions is also a binomial distribution. So finally, with a little bit of math, you can show that the objective function reduces to that integral. The part to the left of the integral is a constant, so it can be dropped. And you can see that if you want to maximize this integral, you should choose the lowest value of alpha as possible. So alpha technically should be zero if you want to maximize that integral. But remember, there is a click-through rate constraint. So without going into all the mathematics, we could show that the optimal solution here is to find the lowest value that just meets your click-through rate constraint. Lowest value of the threshold that just meets the click-through rate constraint. Anything more, if at the end of the month the publisher wanted 0.01 and you did 0.02, then that is a bad thing because you have let some opportunities go by. If the publisher wanted 0.01 and you did 0.005, then that is also a bad thing because the publisher will complain. I asked for 0.01, but you've delivered only 0.005. So both ways we need to be careful. We don't want to go too much, and we certainly don't want to go below. Now, one thing that is interesting, which is for practical interest, is how does the publisher know what value CTR constraint, what value to set? In other words, can Chitika help the publisher make a good decision about the click-through rate constraint? The publisher can kill themselves by choosing a very high click-through rate constraint because you won't get any revenue, you won't get any clicks. Chitika will just not be able to show ads. So what we did was we created a tool. We looked at the publisher's traffic. We looked at the p-values coming to the publisher and said, okay, on the x-axis, you pick a number which you think your click-through rate constraint should be, and the y-axis value will give you what revenue we expect you will make at the end of the month and what click-through rate we will deliver at the end of the month. Notice that this constraint, suppose you set that constraint to zero, it doesn't mean that the click-through rate will be zero. It just means that we will show ads to everybody, which means the click-through rate will be whatever the population average, unfiltered population average is, which is why at zero, there is still a expected click-through rate of about 0.003. Look at the right-hand y-axis, and you see that even when you set the constraint target to zero, you do get some clicks. But as you increase that thing, as you move from the left to the right on the x-axis, the click-through rate increases, but the revenue starts falling. Now, the publisher has to make a judgment where they want to live on this graph. But we provide them with all the information so that they don't hang themselves. Another level of complexity that I want to introduce now is this notion of static versus dynamic. Let us think we have a planning horizon of 30 days. Theoretically, we could keep a value of alpha and hold it constant for the entire month. But what we could also do is we could, for example, take a value of alpha, look at what happened on the first day, get that feedback, and then see what we should do to update alpha. So alpha updating is the dynamic approach. Alpha constant is the static approach. Not very surprising, these terminology. So imagine here that you started and at day zero there were no impressions for, obviously the problem hasn't begun, so impressions are zero, clicks are zero, and both the static and dynamic set a value of alpha to be 0.0082. Now the first day transpired and stuff happened in the world, and it turned out, because the same alpha was kept, we would expect the same performance. So these numbers are not different for the first day because we're basically running the same system. But at the end of the first day, we decided, based on our model, that we should lower the value of alpha. Why did we decide that? We felt that we did well with respect to meeting the constraint at the end of the month, so we can afford to take some risks. So we lowered the alpha. So you can think about alpha as opening a door. then the door is wide open, all people come in, good and bad. As you start closing the door, you start selecting who gets into the room. So if on your first day you opened the door wide, or let's say you were tight on the first day and you did really well, then on the second day you can afford to take a chance. That's basically the theme behind the dynamic model. Now, evaluating the constraint, this is the publisher's click-through rate constraint. This is a complex process, so I'm a little bit behind time, I think, right? So let me speed up a little. This constraint requires a lot of time-consuming calculations. So we had to find an approximation for this constraint, particularly because we were interested in running the dynamic model. Now, why was this time constraint important? So we went back to give you a real feel for why this time constraint was important. Let's go back to the real world, what we did in the implementation. So the first part of the picture is the same. You have users, you have the geo-balancer, you have the data center, etc. Now let's go one more level deeper into the architecture. What happens at the end of every hour in this architecture is all the local log processors send their information to a master log processor. Basically, it collects all the information about what happens in that hour, collects in the master log processor. Then we take that information and we do some analysis on that. It's called roll-up. That basically matches impressions to clicks. It turns out that the same ad server may not be handling the impression and the click. They may be two different ad servers, although they may are likely to be in the same data center. So once that roll-up and impression-to-click matching is done, we feed it to our decision model, which computes a new value of alpha, and then it is broadcast to the various data centers. So the point is that once this log processor gives us the data after 1 hour, we cannot wait for another half an hour to recompute our alpha. And that is sort of the time required if you want to do it precisely. So we had to do some smart approximation here for that constraint. And basically what we did was not very great. What we did was we looked at the ratio whose expectation we needed to calculate and asked ourselves, how bad can we be if we calculate it as a ratio of the expectations? It turns out that you can prove that this approximation is extremely accurate as n is large, as the size of the data is large, many impressions, many clicks. This approximation is accurate up to about 5 decimal places. And it can be done really fast. So at the end of the day, we use the dynamic approach, but we use the approximation. Let me show you a table which tells you how good this approximation. Look at the yellow highlighted portions. The exact is calculating the click-through rate using the true formula for the expectation of the ratio, and the approximate is using the ratio of the expectations. And you can see up to the 5th decimal place, we are accurate. So both theoretically and practically, we are convinced that this approximation is indeed something we can use. What is also important is look at the CPU time. It sometimes takes no time, no appreciable time, sometimes like 0.01 of a second, whereas the other one is just intolerably long given our real-time application. This graph is just showing how the dynamic approach is changing, whereas the static approach is the same. And although the first period it is the same, in the second period it changes the value of alpha, the dynamic approach. And then at the end of the horizon, you see that the dynamic approach has generated 1,500, close to 1,600 clicks, whereas the static approach has generated about 900 clicks. And the reason why the static approach generated less clicks is that its click-through rate was unnecessarily high. It's not highlighted there, but the 0.02 was much more than the 0.01 constraint that the publisher asked for. Whereas the other guy did almost at 0.01. So here it wasted a lot of opportunities. That is why we went lower on clicks. So we are all interested in bottom line impact. What happened? Implementation began in March 2010, and these are some revenue numbers per day. These numbers are probably conservative, as I will show you a little later. It's about 1.2 million a year. The main thing is they launched Chitika Premium, and they told publishers that you go and choose whatever click-through rate you want, and we will deliver it. So what Chitika was having problems with is because it was a startup, and let's say it wanted Wall Street Journal to show its ad, the online Wall Street Journal to show its ads. Wall Street Journal would say, well, are you going to send junk traffic to us? How do we know you're going to deliver? How do we know that you're going to generate clicks for us and not show useless ads? So what Chitika told them is, okay, you tell us what click-through rate you want. Now give us a chance. And for example, Wall Street Journal would go with Google as their advertiser, ad firm. What Chitika would tell them is, well, Chitika plus Google, we can prove to you will be greater than Google alone. So with this marketing strategy, they were able to go to very prominent publishers and get contracts. In UK, they were able to get the UK publisher, very large one, I cannot mention it, but this one wanted Chitika to demonstrate a 1.5% click-through rate. At the end of 3 months, we gave them 1.51. Of course, this is some serendipity here. I don't claim that the model is that accurate. But at the end of the day, this ad partner was asked Chitika, what magic did you do? We wanted 1.5 and you did 1.51. So we said, well, don't take that number into so seriously, but we can usually come very close to your constraint with our model. And then there was another program they launched in December 2010, which said, if you don't want to show ads on search traffic, but there's other traffic, and can you monetize that revenue? It's similar to the same idea, so I won't talk much about it because of time pressure. Venkat right now is working with a large ad partner to generate more revenue. In fact, I was on the phone with him a few minutes ago, and he told me that this solution is working very well to convince them to give them the right to show ads on three of their big properties. So today, 4 billion impressions per month are handled by Chitika, and as it turns out, that this might generate something like doubling their volume in the next few months by convincing them that they are able to deliver on a target click-through rate. So we asked them questions like, what impact did Chitika Premium have? And one of the important things he said that we got win-backs. Publishers would drop out. We could go back to them with these programs and say that we'll give you what you want. And that's how he won back a lot of customers. This is the case where the non-search traffic could be monetized using our method. So that was Chitika Select. And basically, we were interested in seeing what are the clients thinking about your solution. Of course, you are happy with our solution, but are your clients happy? So they went to big publishers, and these big publishers basically, at the end of the day, they were saying, well, if you can increase our revenue beyond Google, we welcome you in the door. The long-term impact on Chitika is it's a very fascinating direction where the ad industry is going, where we plan to use the solution next. And this is the area of real-time bidding. And I'm going to talk about real-time bidding quickly. What is happening in real-time bidding is very fascinating. Today, the ad industry is working on auctions for keywords. So let's say Pizza Hut wants its ads to be shown to people looking for pizza. Pizza Hut goes into an auction to bid for the word pizza. When somebody searches pizza, if it wins that auction, its ad comes. So all this is done before the actual search happens. Now what is happening is that as visitors go to a website, At that time, an auction starts. And these are called ad exchanges. These ad exchanges, when the visitor has hit the website, spreads information to various ad firms and says, do you want the rights to show an ad to this visitor? The bidding begins, and the requirements are to finish this bidding in 100 milliseconds. So, which is an extremely tight constraint, because remember there are network delays, etc., etc. So, there's a lot of operations research, a lot of data analytics that will be used in this solution. But we are able to help them, and this is going to start happening in January, we are going to be able to help them bid the right amount on the impression. So, because Chitika's network, we are gathering information when this visitor... So imagine you know visitors who come to mall X, but you know nothing about visitors who go to mall Y. But some visitors go from mall X to mall Y. So when they are in X, we learn about them. When they go to mall Y, the ad exchange sends us those visitors. And we say, this one with the yellow shirt and the blue hat. Yes, yes, we want to show an ad to this person. So we will bid high on that. The other important direction that this is going to is the inclusion of a conversion constraint. Basically, the idea here is not just to stop at a click, but to also look at conversion data. Did the visitor buy the product? So all that is being generated through the solution of predicting the probability of a click. I will stop here. I think I'm looking at some anxious faces, so probably I'm beyond time, so...